SpaceX jettisoning the hot stage ring. How can we call it a fully reusable rocket now? Yesterday's rocket lab launch. Hey, I'm Lucas. Welcome to the SpaceX community. Let's get started. Welcome back. I hope you all are doing well. In our last episode, we mentioned the hot stage ring jettison, HSRE, and I was surprised that nobody brought it up in the comments. Most of you focused on the filter blockage, which happened during Flight 3, or the upcoming Starliner launch instead. However, one person did ask about it and shared a thoughtful comment. Jettisoning the hot stage adapter will lessen the landing mass and change the center of gravity. But doesn't that work against the ultimate goal of rapid reusability? I won't name this person, but I really appreciate that at least someone cared enough to bring it up. So, today we'll dive deeper into this topic because it's crucial and deserves our attention. Let's discuss the implications and details of the upcoming hot stage ring jettison happening on Flight 4 of the Starship Super Heavy. In SpaceX's latest blog post on the Flight 3 report and upcoming changes for Flight 4, they mentioned, upgrades derived from the flight test will debut on the next launch from Starbase on Flight 4, as we turn our focus from achieving orbit to demonstrating the ability to return and reuse Starship and Super Heavy. The team incorporated numerous hardware and software improvements in addition to operational changes, including the jettison of the Super Heavy's hot stage adapter, following boost back to reduce booster mass for the final phase of flight. So what is meant by hot stage adapter jettison? Before directly addressing that, let's go back to Flight 2. After Flight 1, SpaceX introduced the concept of hot stage separation for the Starship Super Heavy to increase the efficiency and payload capacity of the spacecraft. In this method, most of the 33 Raptor engines on the Super Heavy booster are turned off, but a few remain firing when the engines on the Starship upper stage are ignited. This avoids the loss of thrust during traditional stage separation, where the lower stage shuts down first. The hot stage separation involves the Starship firing up its own 6 engines to push itself away from the Super Heavy booster. To make this method safe for the booster, an additional ring section was installed on Starship's interstage to direct the blow of the engines. This method could potentially increase Starship's payload to orbit capacity by 10%. Now, why do they want to jettison this additional ring section? I think this change is part of a broader effort to reduce the mass of the Super Heavy booster. A fully fueled booster has a mass of up to 3,500 tons. After liftoff, the mass reduces as the propellant is used up. During its return phase, it would barely have the fuel for the boostback burn and landing. As you know, for the Falcon 9, SpaceX mentioned that they only keep the fuel necessary for the same process. This is done to reduce the mass of the rocket as much as possible. This same principle applies to the Super Heavy booster too. But additionally, if they could remove some more mass that significantly doesn't contribute to the landing process, isn't it good to remove that? Of course it is. That's the reason why they are jettisoning the hot stage adapter. By jettisoning, SpaceX aims to minimize the risk of potential difficulties during landing and maximize the chances of successful recovery and reuse with improved control over the booster. The HSR ejection will occur shortly after the boostback burn shutdown process. So how much does this additional portion weigh? My best guess is that it weighs around 10 tons. You may be wondering if this could cause a mass discharge and affect the entire mass distribution. Of course, there will be an effect, but SpaceX will try to balance that with the propellant or any additional measures. Another big question that revolves around is whether they had jettisoned the HSR for Flight 3. To investigate this, I rewatched the Flight 3 launch video, but couldn't see anything. If they had done that in Flight 3, I don't think they would have specifically mentioned it in their post. What are your thoughts? I really want to know your opinion. After watching the video, please re-watch the Flight 3 launch and come back and comment if it happened or not. Any comment with proof will get a big shout-out in our next episode. So, coming to our most important and final question. Does this jettison process make Starship Super Heavy a completely non-reusable rocket? To call a rocket entirely reusable, we have to recover and reuse all the significant and costly components, such as the first stage, second stage, payload fairing, and control systems, etc. This is because some components, like fuel and protective shielding, are typically expendable and not designed for recovery. In this case, I strongly believe that this decision to eject the hot stage ring is a temporary measure while they work on a more advanced design for the ring section that can be retained throughout the mission. For the meantime, for Flight 4, the HSR ejection will be a critical step in achieving a successful landing of the booster in the ocean. So that's all about the hot stage ring ejection process. I hope I was able to give a simple but clear idea of how it works and why they are doing it. I will get into this deeper after Flight 4, so make sure that you have subscribed to our community, where crucial things like these are first discussed. Moving on to the Flight 4 upgrades. SpaceX has made an official announcement regarding the upcoming Flight 4 of its Starship program. The Flight 4 timeline will closely resemble that of Flight 3, with some key differences. After stage separation, the Super Heavy booster will conduct a boost-back burn, followed by the HSR ejection. The Starship will then re-enter the Earth's atmosphere, flip, and perform a landing burn. Notably, Flight 4 will not include some of the activities that were part of Flight 3, such as opening and closing the payload bay door, in-space burns, and propellant demonstrations. Instead, the focus will be on demonstrating the ability to return and reuse the Starship and Super Heavy. SpaceX has also announced a specific launch date for Flight 4, June 5th. While this date is still pending regulatory approval, it aligns with previous statements from Elon Musk and the company. The preparations for Flight 4 are underway, with the Starship S-29 and Super Heavy B-11 already destacked after completing the wet dress rehearsal test. The teams have conducted final checks within the last 2 days, and now the ship is almost ready to be stacked atop the booster. That's all about the today's SpaceX Starship update. Now let's move on to other updates. Yesterday, at 3:41 a.m. Rocket Lab successfully launched an Electron rocket from its New Zealand site, carrying the first of two CubeSats for NASA's Prefire, Polar Radiant Energy in the Far Infrared Experiment, climate studying mission. The satellite was deployed into orbit 53 minutes after launch as planned, marking a significant milestone in the study of Earth's climate. The Prefire mission aims to measure the heat lost from Earth's polar regions, a crucial aspect of climate study that has not been systematically done from orbit. The two 6U CubeSats, each the size of 6 4-inch cubes, will be placed in different 326-mile-high circular orbits above Earth, providing valuable data on the polar region's energy balance. The Electron rocket, standing 59 feet tall, is designed to provide dedicated rides to orbit for small satellites. This launch marked the 48th overall for the Electron, demonstrating its reliability and efficiency. Rocket Lab is working towards making the first stage of the Electron reusable, having recovered boosters from the sea after multiple launches and preparing to refly a first stage for the first time. This launch is not the first time Rocket Lab has partnered with NASA for climate studying missions. In May 2023, Rocket Lab launched the four satellites of NASA's TROPICS constellation, which monitors the evolution of tropical storms over two Electron launches. The second Prefire satellite is scheduled to launch within 3 weeks of today's launch, although the exact date has not been announced. Rocket Lab will conduct this launch, continuing its support for NASA's climate studying initiatives. The use of CubeSats in space missions has revolutionized the industry, offering a cost-effective and efficient way to conduct scientific research and technology demonstrations. The U in 6U cubes at stands for unit, a cube 4 inches on a side that serves as the basic building block of CubeSats. This design allows for flexibility and adaptability in mission design and execution. Today's successful launch marks an important step in the study of Earth's climate and the polar region's energy balance. Rocket Lab's partnership with NASA demonstrates the company's commitment to supporting scientific research and advancing our understanding of the Earth's climate. As the second Prefire satellite prepares for launch, we can expect further insights into the complex dynamics of our planet's climate system. Thanks for watching today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another great video tomorrow.